We're back with a crispy, fresh episode of Take It Personal. And this time, we're joined by special guest, Mr. Eon of the High and Mighty. Eon sits in with us as we take it back to the late 90s and early 2000s, where the indie era was extremely prominent. And now, let's welcome a man who was an intricate part of this indie era, Mr. Eon.
Yo, just relax.
Yup, y'all know the name.
Right now you're tuned in to Take It Personal.
I'm ready to put y'all up on something, man.
The revolution is here.
No doubt.
Yo, this is KRS-One. Checking out the Take It Personal radio show.
Yo, check it out, y'all. This is DJ Premier.
Yo, what's up? It's Black Thought from the Legendary Roots Crew. And you checking out Take It Personal radio.
Yo, check this out. It's the Soul Brother number one, Pete Rock.
Yo, what's up? This is Diamond D representing Digging in the Crates right here on Take It Personal radio. The best in hip hop.
You are now checking out.
Y'all know the name. It's your boy Pharoahe Monch. You already know what it is. I want to give a big shout out to the Take It Personal show.
This is Chuck D.
This is Flavor Flav, boy.
And you checking it out. Take It Personal. So, yo, do that.
Right now, you listening to Take It Personal. Spinning that fly shit. You heard.
Yo, what's up? It's Eric Summon, the Green Knight Bandit, representing the EPMD. Here on Take It Personal radio. This is the truth.
Check them out.
Yo, what's up? It's your artist named Kool Keith. You're checking out Take It Personal
with my people.
Y'all care anymore about this hip hop, man?
Ha ha ha.
What you waiting for?
Got a style, I'm mad. I'm right.
Check it out, it's your boy MC Surgeon. Right now, you're checking out Take It Personal. It's not a game.
Take it personal.
Alright, yo, ladies and gentlemen, right now, if you don't know what the fuck is about to go on, this is Take It Personal. With my boy Philip Flavor, Kevlar, A-Aaron, Roger the Announcer, and DJ 360 with his stinking ass. This is Take It Personal, and we in the building, yeah.
All right, back from the break, and I'm going to take the ball right here and run with it like fucking Bo Jackson in Super Tecmo Bowl, because that's how we get down on this show. And we are privileged to have a pioneer from the indie era and a group that made a huge impact from the late 90s up through the mid-2000s. Mr. Eon from the High and the Mighty and Eastern Conference Records. Welcome to the show, my man. Good to talk to you.
Thank you, man. Thank you very much for having me.
From about, I don't know, what, 98 to maybe 05, they were a force in the indie scene.
97, yeah. Right? I think your first single came out in 97.
Yeah, I think right at the end of like 96 and early 97, yeah.
I remember sending Ed from Sandbox a check for your first single with Bobbito.
Really?
Wasn't that your first single with Bobbito? Hands
well,
on?
We did. No, I think we did. Well, I did the first one with Rashid, who's, ill-advised and all those.
Yeah.
And It's How I'm Living. That was on Rashid's song. I think that was Quake City. I think that was Newt and those guys.
Newt Cohen.
Yeah, that was the first appearance. And then we did, the first single.
The first High and Mighty record.
The first High and Mighty record was the single. Cranial Lumps and Hands on Experience. And then the other joint. And yeah, that was amazing. And being able to just, jump right in. Like it took us basically moving to New York and 2 years of Mighty kind of getting his foot in DJing and meeting people and then kind of just kept making music. So we were lucky enough to kind of just start off like that.
So E, from the jump, I you had mentioned Bobbito, that single that you had done. Most people don't know, but let's talk about that early meeting with Bob. If I'm not mistaken, at Boston University, he was throwing a party, and did he approach you and ask you to come up to KCR? I mean, what was that story? And if you can elaborate, when you actually did go to WKCR, You know, this is where they had the Stretch and Bobbito show, WKCR 89 Tech 9. We would love to hear a great story from those sacred walls, you know, good, bad, and the ugly ones.
Yeah, for sure. Well, the whole thing at BU was dope. I think there was some show that he was putting on, and there was some girl who was like cute, who I think she was like, in some way we hung out with her and knew her, and then she like, you know, I don't know if he was trying to get with her or something, but like he was like rapping with her, and then he came over, like he was just like in our crib, and like we lived on Marlboro Street right off Mass Ave. And for whatever reason, he came up, and then it was like, I remember like Ma was like, yo, Bobbito's coming, and like, you know, think of something that's, you know, to rhyme about, like try to, you know, rhyme for him in some way. So I think it just came, you know, like real naturally, because they're, you know, like the Stretch and Bob whole thing is just, it's so like natural. So he was just like, yeah, man, kick some shit. And I did. And he was like, okay. He was like, dope. He was like, you know, when you guys are in New York, you know, come through. And while that was happening, Mai, you know, was a big club DJ in Boston. And as, you know, he went, and as we like graduated from BU, so that was like 93. And so we were still at BU. And then one time we went up there, and because Mai was like talking to Stretch, and like he started to like kind of, you know, get involved. Just kind of with like the scene, even though we were still in Boston, like we went a couple times to New York. And then I just remember going, just being like, that time was just completely, you know, nerve wracking.
Right.
Cause I was like, you know, it was just, you know, at that point, I didn't really know if I was going to have a whole hip hop career and all that. Like, you're really literally in college, and, you know, I'm like 22 or whatever. And so doing that, that was like the hugest thing that told me I could do it, you know? And so like being able to actually, you know, go up there first, you know, doing this for Bobbito and rhyming for him and him thinking it's dope. And then to go there, and it was pretty good. I remember like, if I look back, it was like in my weird Kool Keith, like weird voice thing. I don't know if you've ever heard that. It's like, you gotta go back and listen to it. But, you know, it was dope. And, like, then we went back there, you know, a lot of other times. And those were some of the more funny times where, like, you know, ill, like, there wasn't a lot of room back there. You know, a lot of stuff like that. So it was a lot of fun, you know.
So they're synonymous with having, like, way too many heads inside the studio at the time. And right. People knocking on the door, trying to get in. Do you remember who was kind of up there or trying to get up there at the time? I mean,
well, at that one, I think we just got in, and I think me and Mai just went up one time. I don't know if we ever went up with Ill-Advised and Rashid, but we went up. It was, I think it was just me and Mai, if I remember correctly. But then, like, you know, the other times when it was like Camus, Cage, Yak Balls, you know, Copyright, me, and then Mai would be there, and like other people would be there. Those were crazy because you would have to shuffle in. Like, you would have three chairs and like five dudes. And so here are the three dudes rhyming. You have to like rhyme and sneak off. And it was like this pattern. And then like, then it was funny. So that was, you know, those were some funny times. I never really had any violent things there because they weren't having that. But
right.
I remember like all the records there and stuff, and like Stretch would dig in there and stuff, and like Mai would look at the records sometimes in there too.
Mr. E.
Yeah, we got somebody else up
there. We got Mr. E.
Yeah. Yo. Pen to paper, the notebook, the caper. Elaborate sound blast found across faders. Pencil me in when the enemy spin. F the cavalry, they're sending E in. Desperate times bring desperate measures. An ounce or an eighth or a pint of whatever. Militant weed smoker, pass the jokers. Pocket full of sticky for a pocket full of cloners. The lab rat, spit science and add to that. Got diseases most heads would laugh at. For all y'all, it's a world of hurt. When I'm held up in a compound just like Colonel Kurtz. Yes.
Well, another big DJ in New York at the time was Mark Ronson, and most people don't realize how underground he was at the time.
Yeah,
he was playing at Rehab. I used to DJ with him as well back in the day. And there's a funny story, and I'd like you to tell it if you could, how he was, if I'm not mistaken, I think he was seeing Rashida Jones, Quincy Jones's daughter at the time, and he had a big part in kind of getting you guys set up.
Yeah, well, I think Mai had a big part in, like, kind of, you know, Mark is obviously musically talented, you know, but at that point, you know, A, he was younger than us, and DJ, you don't really know, but I don't know, I guess they were seeing each other, but I know they lived together, and it was just like, you know, they didn't really, you know, they were very young. If I was, like, 25, they must have been, you know, 20-something, like, and so Mai was kind of with, you know, Ronson and, like, Stretch, but, like, Mai kind of really would, like, go over blends and stuff. And, like, obviously, you know, Mark picked it up right away, and he was, you know, he became a big club DJ. But, you know, there was a time that we all, you know, we all hung out because they had this crazy crib. What it was is they lived together, but I don't know if they dated because it was weird. Like, but they had this, like, crazy crib that was, like, probably, you know, 1997 or something, and it was, or 98, and it was just, you know, gigantic crib that these two young kids were at. But, you know, then it's like, oh, it's Quincy Jones' daughter. And
not only that, when your dad's in Foreigner, you're making, you got space, you don't have those 600 square foot places.
Yeah.
Well, if it was 1997, there was probably a 50-inch screen and money green leather sofas, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And Super Nintendo and Sega Genesis.
Yeah.
But I remember, because, you know, he's done like mixes and stuff on our really early records. And then, you know, she was on Dick Starbuck, and, you know, she was on, you know, Rashida Jones was on some of our songs. So that all would just be how, like, we all hung out. It's like, you know, we had, that's like what happened so many aspects of our career, you know, just meeting a certain person through this person and then, like, you know, something amazing happening, you know. So we were lucky and we were in the right place at the right time and young and hungry and, you know, sort of talented.
You guys grew up together in grade school. I know you went to the same grade school since like third grade or whatever. Yeah. So you go way back. At what point did you actually say, hey, let's make some fucking songs together and see what happens? When did that happen? And at what point did you go, hey, I think we got something here?
Well, in 1987, we went to the Beastie Boys, Murphy's Law, Public Enemy.
Yeah, I was at that concert. That was a great show.
And what it was walking into the Philadelphia Spectrum, which is, you know, like the Garden in Philly. And I walked into, like, Public Enemy number one, the song. Hmm. So, you know, you don't even hear that, like, any of that kind of music. Like, whatever hip-hop you heard, I kind of just thought it was, like, you know, with that, like that. I was just, you know, we bugged out. Hmm. And then we had a talent show in May of 1987. And I think we have a picture of it. And we performed. And we just rhymed over that, and we did, you know, like, we were freshmen in high school, and we just, like, rapped on stage, but, like, did, like, you know, it was probably corny, but it was dope. And then, so that was, we were in ninth grade, we did, like, all the talent shows through senior year, we had dancers, and, like, you know, and, like, Mai was, like, doing, like, a whole, like, routine, and then we just, so then I went to Northeastern to start off in college, and he went to BU, and it kind of just happened, but, you know, it was good that we did. And then Milo in 1991, we did some stuff and we recorded some stuff in Boston. But then in 92, Mai got an MPC 60, and then that was it. So he just started making beats and we just started making songs. And then, you know, in 94, 95, we moved to New York. So then we just kept doing songs in, like, 96. Like, even the ones before, like, the first record, were kind of, like, we really were progressing. Like, let's you know, this is good, but let's like do this. And then like Mai didn't even have like a really equipment. And then we, in 92, we did. And that's when he just took off with, you know, production and learning that machine. And then, you know, as he built his studio. And so I think like 96, that's when we ran, you know, being in New York for 2 years and Mai DJed for 2 years. And he made, you know, awesome connections like Rich King at Fat Beats and the whole Fat Beats crew. Like we linked and we finally, you know, gave them something. And then they linked us with like LP and like Mike Zoot. And then we just were in that world. Like I was doing New Eurekan Poets Cafe stuff and going to Fat Beats. So even though I didn't like grow up in New York with like that whole scene, then I kind of moved there in 94 and was doing that. And then like 90s, you know, we just kept doing songs. And then, you know, 96 in November, that's when we recorded all those and they came out. So I think that's how, you know, that's how it progressed.
So you went from Philly to Boston to New York. You talked about the way you guys grew up together. Would you say those experiences in those cities kind of molded you into this group? Like, did you take something out of Boston and out of Philly when you went to New York? Because of your mindset is different in each city, I would imagine.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, like Philly was just growing up. And so, like, you know, the obvious sports, you know, the sports, the hip hop, you know, we grew up in Center City. So, you know, people don't know Philly. It's kind of like outskirts, and then it's like downtown. Like we grew up downtown, kind of. And so there were these record stores called Sound and Market. It was like, you went and did everything. There was like Sound and Market was just a record store, but it also had, you know, VHS and stuff or whatever. And there was a few of them, Sound and Market. And then there was Funko Mart. So there was, you know, you went out with your boys and like, then there were sneakers and there was this place called I. Goldberg's that had all the starter jackets and posters. And, you know, so that was like, that's how we grew up. We grew up going like, you know, And like me and mine, when we were 16, we worked in Foot Locker in the gallery so we could get sneaks. So we were just, that's what Philly was. And then Boston was really like maturing as an MC and like my, you know, he DJed in like Lansdowne, which was like the main clubs, you know, like in college, like he was doing really well. And I just remember, you know, going and hanging out with some of the, you know, the Boston groups. And that was really in terms for me, like emceeing and obviously going to college. But like that was the more like competitiveness of it and meeting different people and not just, you know, like taking it more seriously.
So you're on that alumni list with Howard Stern and Jason Alexander. Who else went to BU? I'm trying to think. There's some.
I forget. Rick Pitino coached there.
Okay.
I don't know. Apparently it's like it got really good. Like when I was there, the business school hadn't been built yet, right? It was still Burger King and like on Mass Ave. And then I think I left like 94 and then it like really flourished. They built this business school and like now I hear it's like really hard to get into and all that.
Yeah. So I want to ask this quick question before we kind of go back to the music, but you talked about the New York. Is that where you became such a diehard Mets fan? Or no, is it your Mets age fan. And nope. They happen to win the World Series and then you gravitated towards them? I can't for the love of God figure this out.
Here it is, man.
Yes.
Fellow diehard right here.
This is killing me.
Diehard right here.
I went to the World's Fair and fell in love with Queens.
No. I was the hugest Phillies fan, man. On my wall, I have We Win. I have a newspaper that I bought. Like
It's in here.
Old.
All that stuff is in here.
Right.
In the booklet.
Yeah, it's all in the back. And then, so then I'm 8 years old. So then in 2 years, they from 82 to 84, they got rid of every one of my heroes. They had Pete Rose left. They traded Boa and Bob Junior and them for, and Moreland for Ivan De Jesus. Like Steve Carlton left to the Indians or whatever. That was like a little bit later, but I just felt like they, and I was like immature and stupid. And I was like, I was like frustrated in like 82. And then even in 83, I started liking, I think it was like because like I heard of Daryl Strawberry.
That was his rookie year.
I think I fell in love with him, man. And I was super into baseball cards. So in 1983, I knew every like starting team of every like team, like the starting infield. And so I really literally felt betrayed. And I just didn't know any better. And so then Dwight Gooden came and they got like Keith Hernandez and George Foster. So it was like all these guys that I loved.
Gary Carter.
And baseball was number one. Back then, no one will tell you different. Like baseball was, anyone who's 50, I'm 50. It's like baseball was like the highest level. Mm-hmm. So we were into that. And then like the summer of 84 was like the first year I started really following the Mets. And that was like they lost to the Cubs in the NL East. Then the next year they even got better and they lost to the Cardinals. And then I remember and it just rolled into it. And I was like a freshman in high school. So I don't know. And look, man, they haven't done shit since. So that was 14. That was 36 years ago.
Well,
so
I know
no
you're
jokes
you're
on me.
You're a diehard Eagles fan. I always see you.
20-year season ticket holder.
I always see you every Sunday in the home games doing your thing in the parking lot. I know you're
dude, love the music blasting in the parking lot. It makes everybody's day.
So, you know, you're a diehard Eagles, diehard Sixers, and I don't know how you gravitated towards the Mets, but there
you go. That's what it was, man. And I literally was the only one, you know, like, obviously. Like, they all killed me. They were just killing me.
You watch an episode of the Baseball Bunch back in the day and you fell in love with someone. Come on, who are you fooling?
Right. Gary Carter. Remember, they announced it during like an NFL game. It was great.
There is there's another rapper who's another diehard Eagles fan, and I would just love to hear your side of what fucking transpired. But if you guys don't know who I'm talking about, it's Masta Ace.
and
Masta Ace, for those that don't know, is a huge Eagles fan. He's also one of those guys who's never ever had beef other than getting jaw jacked by Fat Joe once. You've never heard anything about Masta Ace beefing with people. Somehow Masta Ace put out a diss record over what we were told is a misunderstanding. But now that we have you 20 some years later, I'd love to hear what the fuck happened.
Well, I'll start it off with when we lived in New York, we used to go with John Schechter, who started The Source, and we would go to this one sports bar and different people would show up there. Like we had some weird people, like, I don't know, like Mild Stars or something of the early 90s. And like, and then like Masta Ace came and it was I just have a weird memory. 1994 when we beat beat San Fran the year they won the Super Bowl, 95. We beat them and we were at the sports bar and he was with us. So it was like group of six, dude. We were all talking about the Eagles. And then we were talking that we rapped and stuff. And like we were fully like Masta Ace Eon. Like he knew who me and my were. And we had other experiences. So then fast forward to whenever it was, I think it was for Cage's album, we were at like a new music seminar, CMJ or one of those Johns, and Cage was doing Suicidal Failure. And in the song, he says, you know, pumping Masta Ace, I walked into a Jewish slaughterhouse.
I drank a bottle of Jack, sniffed three bottles of Kitty in the middle of the freeway, walking to the city. So much PCP, I changed my name to Watermouth. Pumping Masta Ace, I walked into a Jewish slaughterhouse.
So it's not a diss of Ace, it's just like a play on words, right? So he had one of his dudes, like, who either was in his crew or something, named Tone Deaf, which is the funniest part of the whole thing, that this is the dude who heard this, and his name is Tone Deaf, and that he heard that and was like, yo, Ace, the High and Mighty dissed you, and said, fuck Masta Ace Slaughterhouse. And that's what happened. So then he did it, and then we heard it, and we were like, what? And then we put it together. And then someone told us that. And then, like, Mighty My, like, we like then talked to him, and he was like, Ace, it's me, Milo. Remember, like, we used to go and watch the Eagles games together and stuff like that. And then I think Ace was like, oh yeah. And he was like, look, man, like, that was a dude. And he played him the record. And there's actually, they did it on something. Like, I think it's recorded or something. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but like, it was a known, you know. And then he was like, oh yeah, sorry. Or like, whatever. It wasn't real.
So it should have been something directed towards Cage. But you guys got lumped into it.
Yeah, because it was just like, I think we were at that point like off the album. And so maybe Tone Deaf just didn't even know who Cage was. He just saw maybe me and Mai up there with him. And that's what, you know, because we were all like all on the stage.
And Tone Deaf, is this the Tone Deaf from QN5? He's a rapper, that Tone Deaf?
Yes. Yes. I think so. Yeah.
Wow.
Good call.
Yeah, that's you know, you hear different stories, but I wanted to hear from you, because for years I could not figure out what really happened. But that's crazy. So obviously, once you had that discussion, he's like, oh, my bad, the song is already out there. Did you guys ever at any point in time consider putting a response record out?
No, I think I said one line was old timers, Alzheimer's, some shit. Said in one song, I forget which one, and that was just the only little thing.
Meanwhile, he's your age.
Yeah, of right. course. I'm probably older than him. No,
it was a low key diss. Yeah. It was low key.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
it was just a damn, man. He didn't really do his research, you know, type thing.
Since we brought it up, Cage, let's talk about this for a minute. I know that Bobbito introduced you guys to Cage, and kind of how did it happen that you paired up with Cage and ended up getting to the point of making an album, Smut Peddlers, and then other songs with Cage?
We met him, yeah, through Bob, and I think it was kind of after, you know, Agent Orange and Radiohead, like that single, and I think he was coming off of, you know, whatever with Pete Nice and all that stuff. So I think in like, you know, that was like 98, and like we met with him, and we were just like, first of all, I was like a huge fan. Like, I was just like, yeah. Like, Mai was like, why don't we ask Cage? That's all we used to do, is like people we like, we'd be like, yo, like, let's try to link up with him. And yeah. And so then we hung out, and like we went to Middletown, and like we hung out with him, and you know, he had his little crib, and it was like, and we were just like vibing. And then we were really like, yo, man, we love your stuff. And like, let's, you know, you want to come into the city, and, you know, we'll chill and do it. And we just kind of vibed out. We just, you know, we did the one with Masai Bay, and like, you know, that, you know, for the record, and like that song, and then One by One. And then we kind of rolled that as the whole raucous deal came. It was just like the obvious thing was, you know, High and Mighty, because the album was done, and that's, you know, going into the raucous stuff. But then we just did, like, you know, we did, you know, In Out, and like for the High and Mighty album. So we were just kind of hanging and chilling, and then we were like, yo, we can do a whole album. Like, let's just do a Smut Peddlers album. And we were just like, all right, let's just do it. Like, it was just, you know, we were like, let's have the second album of our label deal be the Smut Peddlers album.
So before you guys went into the whole ruckus era of your career, there was another label that was courting you, Tommy Boy, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What was the part of the deal that made you guys say we should go with this label over the other one?
Well, I think I don't think they wanted to really give us a label deal, or it was just high. It wasn't as concrete. Like, we got a straight 3-album deal from Ruckus. And I think that they wanted the High and Mighty album, because we had done all the work. We had paid all the artists. It was like, it was any label's dream. It was like every contemporary, you know, of that era, and like presenting like, you know, this album.
And they didn't do 3-album deals back then, Ruckus. I mean, they were a singles label, so, you know.
No, but we got a label deal, because that's the whole thing, is that me and Mai were just like, we're not going to be on Fat. You know, it started back when we're like, all right, well, we're going to put out a record. Like, what? Like, that's when we did everything. We were like, you know, what's the label going to be called? And we made that up. And then we made the, you know, it's like, you know, the most fun part.
So you're saying the album was done before you went with Ruckus for the distro deal?
Yeah, like mostly all of it.
Okay, because
so, like, there was a couple pieces.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but I always was under the impression that Ruckus, not that they had a say, but maybe they suggested or made some connections happen. Because for me, I saw Mos Def on there. I saw Pharoahe. So I was always under the assumption that Ruckus put maybe the finishing touches on that album.
No, but it was really about B-Boy Document. Because when we were
there's two versions.
Yeah. So we put out and we met Mos and like we did that, you know, we didn't. So I hear what you're saying. You'd think that, but it really wasn't. It was like we did the Mos Def song and the LP, you know, like we did Hands On Experience with LP.
Correct.
And, you know, we did, you know, the first B-Boy Doc.
Stay independent of all ill intent, non-threat. Won't infiltrate the conference. Abandon your notion of the papes. Planet of the apes. I'm the human who communicates. Invading tempest of this premises. Retarding it. Stay underground regardless. Transplant it to the heartless. The lung donor. Unsigned free agent. So fuck the owner. When I be the incredibleist. Verbal herbalist. So fuck the turbulence. Now let's make the investment. No resentment. Fuck the dotted line on Independence Day.
So we did, like, what it was is Ruckus saw that we did that. We put that out, and Ruckus was, like, up here, and we put out this record that was, like, the same vibe. It had, just like you're saying, their artists on there, and everything. It was just, you know, a synergy. And, like, that's also about the Eminem part and, like, how we got the deal part. So there was a lot of, that's all it was, like, New York synergy of just everything flowing between everyone. It was very cool. So no, like even we wanted open mic night on the album, the beat, and we loved it. But at that point, you know, we had had like a thing with Ill Advised and them. So I was like, let's like, and I liked, and then we were like, all right, let's like, and we just knew everyone. We were like, let's do like Thurston Howell and Wordsworth. So,
but so you
we
you like, can see what I was that. Saying though, because those are
yeah,
all
no,
Ruckus. You know,
so the thing was
how,
about B-Boy Document was Mos does his same verse.
Yep.
And then, you know, Mad Skills, who wasn't on the first record, is there. And we knew him. Mm-hmm. You know, that's another
from,
kind of
is that from Reef?
Thing. What?
Was that from Reef?
Right, exactly. Yeah. Yes. And then, you know, me, I did a different verse. But at the when we first handed it in, we had like a break and it was like my cutting up the original B-Boy Document. So it was like B-Boy to the document, but B-Boy.
That's a Mantronic sample, fellas. You guys fuck with me with the Mantronic shit. That's a Mantronic sample.
It's Crown Rulers.
I'm letting you know, kid. You got an 80s kid here.
No. We interchanged two things, right? We used a Mantronic beat and then we did a like an ode to Crown Rulers and named it B-Boy Document. But all I'm saying is
we're both right.
Dude, that's a Mantronic shit for the people that know. I don't care where you're at. This is
well, that's true.
It is what it is. But I love you for that.
If you want the raucousification part was that they were like Mos, do a dope hook. And so he did the hook.
But the crazy thing is, it seems like you guys got a better deal than almost anybody on Ruckus. And they were dealing with some big fucking stars. How does that happen?
Well, it wasn't like a high and mighty thing. We were like Brian and Jared, like the two owners. So we were our own little, we just rapped. Like the whole thing of Eastern Conference was just because we wanted to own everything. We never wanted to be on. So we just, and back then that's what it was. It was like, well, what do you want to, how do you want to put it out? We were like, I don't know. Like, they were like, well, do you have a BMI? We're like, let's just make a label. So it was a label deal. It wasn't even, and even though that's why all the singles, we just were, yeah. So I think because they knew that like we could do it, like we A&R'd, you know, the Home Field Advantage, which has so many different people on it. And so I think they were like, these guys are self, they do everything in house. you know, and they're going to generate and just produce albums for us. And that's what it was. On the other guys, they'd have to put out, you know, they'd have to record and go to these big studios and stuff. They really didn't do that much with us, you know. So that's where I think maybe they spent a lot more on those guys. I don't know.
You got a lot of Alchemist, early Alchemist production.
Yeah, like, man.
You said open mic night, which is the original. I love the original because I, you know, Philly all the way, but yeah. You had a lot of Alchemist joints throughout, whether it was some Smut Peddlers to the High and Mighty. So obviously you did a lot of networking, but in retrospect, it's kind of cool to know that, hey, I had Alchemist on these albums. I mean, this is...
Yeah, man, we had some of his first stuff. It was just, yeah, it was just another, again, like a synergy of meeting, because he was a freshman at NYU. Mm-hmm. So it was like we met him through someone like at NYU. And then he just, you know, what it was is he had the illest weed. And it was 1997. And that was before all the weed was like incredible. So it was like he had the really good weed. And then we would hang out. And then he'd just play us shit. And we were like, I mean, if you hear top prospects, you're like, oh my God. You hear like open mic night, like he had this shit. Mm-hmm. And it's just, yeah, it was just amazing. And like then, you know, he dropped out of school, obviously. And then, you know, he's just become what he's become, which is.
He became such a failure. He stayed in school.
Beautiful failure.
E, tell us the story about how you connected with Eminem and Royce.
So that was Paul Rosenberg is Eminem's manager. And he's a lawyer, and he was coming from Michigan, and he was linked up with John Schechter, who started The Source. And so they linked up, and I think John helped him out or something in some way. Then we met Paul through John, and he was like, these guys were trying to get a deal. And so, you know, Paul was negotiating M's deal on Interscope. He had just done Eminem's deal on Interscope, you know, and before Eminem came out. And so like it's this timeline of that and then him coming to New York. And if you remember, there are these like group of songs that were all done together and they were all done in like 5 days. So it's like Bad Meets Evil, which was on Game, which is John Schechter.
Yep.
We did, you know, Last Hit. And then Royce did the one that was on Eastern Conference that Reef produced. And then there were two other songs, but they're like, it's just ill. So basically, Scary Movies, right. And we got our deal because Paul Rosenberg was our lawyer. So like all of a sudden, he just negotiated our deal.
Oh,
so like
wow.
All of this is all intertwined. So like as the, I don't even think we were, you know, we went to Tommy Boy first, but then the Raucous thing happened. And it just was like, you know, like Emma done stuff with Raucous. They knew him. And so like, it was all kind of, that's how we hooked up and we were able to record, you know, we did it in Mighty Mai's living room and I wrote it, you know, I wrote everything. I was like, all right, we're going to go back and forth. And he was like, all right, what's the last word of, you know, spina bifida. Okay. And he would just start writing. My man is lifting, you know, 6 feet, you know, and that's how we did the song. And I wrote the hook. And I think we kind of, I think I had most of the hook and then he added parts to it. So, and then we just, you know, we did that song and then, you know, we kind of knew he was going to be really big. I mean, we were like, he's with Dr. Dre. And I think we heard like how my name is before people heard it. And so we knew what was up, I think.
If you strip away all the guest spots, it's still a remarkable album. And I know, yeah. You know, a lot of albums in that era, it was littered with guest spots. But, you know, you guys really made some good music. It's, you know, as you're talking, you're like the Kevin Bacon of hip hop because you have so many connections to so many different people. I'm thinking,
yeah, it is
you know,
weird, man.
Alchemist is Scott Kahn. Rashida Jones is Quincy Jones. I mean, like, there are all these people within, you know, Mark Ronson, all these people within your circle or that you you know, networked with throughout the years. It's pretty remarkable when you think about it, you know?
No, it is. And it's just such a blessing from, you know, like, this has just been, you know, a wild ride, the whole hip hop part. Like, you know, you guys do your interests in hip hop and other things, and then you have like day jobs. And I've had, you know, I'm like 16, 17 years in my day job now. So, you know, my career, whatever that is. And so, yeah, man, I mean, we went to Europe and still, like, it's just endless. Someday we're going to like either do some kind of documentary or.
Yeah. You like, need to write a book, do a documentary, just, something.
Yeah, man. It's just, and it's funny too. It's just so like me and Mai are just like ridiculous.
So it's funny when you strip away all of like, you know, the nonsense, we're all just hip hop heads. We love what we do. We've loved it from whatever era started you with it. You and I seem to be from the same, you know, cloth here. But at the end of the day, what was the, as far as the independent movement, what was stuff that was moving you? I mean, you work with the Mighty LP at one point. I mean,
yeah.
If you really go through El Producto's mind, I mean, he was a fucking ill dude. I mean, he wasn't as weird as Anticon, but he was doing all that static and weird shit at a time when it wasn't really fashionable. And then you kind of bring it forward to where it's at now with Run the Jewels. I mean, this dude's mind should be kind of in a glass case somewhere, because this is crazy. So what was it like working with him, or just in general, who did you kind of vibe out to at that stage of it all?
Well, back then, like, definitely L was it was incredible to work with him, just because, you know, they really came on the scene when we moved to New York, you know, like the 8 steps to perfection. And, you know, like that was just like the biggest thing kind of in this scene, you know, like the Fat Beats underground, like kind of New York scene. And it was just, you know, it was really cool. And then, you know, we all went in 98, but a big formidable part and memory and thing for us was when we first went to Europe. And that was, we went to this thing called the Roskilde Festival. And that was, you know, Pharoahe Monch. And remember, this is Pharoahe Monch in between, like when he first went solo. He didn't have like any songs, like Simon Says didn't exist. And so, you know, it was Arsonist, you know, Nonfiction, Company Flow, us, and then
Super Underground.
Mass Influence.
Mass Influence was a nice one.
Yeah. Oh, yo, H2O was so good.
Yeah, yeah, they're awesome, man. I love that. Those guys are like, you know, and when you go on, you know, those tours, it's like going away like summer camp or like your old school friends. It's just like, you know, I have stories about talking about comic books, playing like sleeping on a floor 5 feet from Pharoahe Monch and like talking about the X-Men. You know, like, I don't really know what you know what you want more from life than stuff like that. I'm just, you know, that's just me, you know, like talking, you know, like, so yeah, man, it's just these memories. And yeah, being able to do that, and like definitely that first album, and then just, but like going to Europe and that expanding, like, I don't know if you guys know, like DJ Noise, who's like, you know, one of the, you know, Technics turntable champions from like the late 90s, like he went with us and he would do like a whole routine. He would like perform with us because like it was really just me. It's like kind of boring. And so like Mai would be DJing, but then like Noise would do like a whole routine. So, I mean, it was just, it was awesome. You know, a lot of different things, you know, from LP and then even Mos Def, man. Like, I have like so many, like one time, remember he was on, I don't know if you know this show, Law and Order, obviously. Yeah. But the real old OG.
He was an actor really before. He was.
Yeah, he was an actor before.
Mm-hmm.
And like when we did the song, like I was like, oh, right. The dude from Law and Order. Like I almost, like I did know of him as an MC, but I was almost like, oh, he's been on the show.
Underground, skin I be, standing 5'10", I be rocking it when I be in your vicinity. Raw style synergy, recognize symmetry. Come up, try to engine me, broke him down chemically. Ain't the number 10 MC, talking about hopping I be, styled it like Kennedy, late like a 10 to 3. When I say when I be, girl, save and I keep, cause this is 10 to be. Way out like Tennessee, take me to a place called the BK without pause or delay. Get run like pen relay, don't deal what he say, she say, ain't working for no cheap pay. most deaf beat played. This what the streets say. Hey, Mr. DJ, play that devil Morgan. That jam got me open. This side of break it broken. From front, side to side, middle to back. Never the whack. I come from Bed-Stuy, Black. From Lewis, A.V.E. to be exact.
Brooklyn!
And then, like, when we were both, like, unknown, one time, like I'm walking down the street, he's like, yo, E! And he just was like, what's up, man? And it was, like, after we recorded B-Boy Documents. And it was, like, all genuine. And then, you know, so, yeah, there's a lot of different memories with a lot of different cool people who went on, you know, to do a lot of amazing stuff. So it was, yeah, it's a cool ride.
It's so relatable. It's like, you know, you warp zoned into this hip hop world. Like, we are living vicariously through your stories now because you're like us, a hip hop head, first and foremost.
Right.
You know, you grew up to this. I mean, when you had Kool Keith on your record, I'm sure it was a dream come true. I mean, he's, you know, like, you would never have imagined you would be rapping alongside Kool Keith.
Yeah, the whole thing was surreal. But then it wasn't.
Yo, I'm $6 million, rapping like I'm Steve Austin, made of steel. Diamonds glitter on the Ampex rim, supercharging my brain cells, glowing extra large in my afro sheen. Skin color should be green. Girls in the backseat with thongs stuck between a boo-boo. I'm rapping through you, on sidelines he's talking to you. My finesse in Batmobiles, cruise with Adam West. Down Bronx streets and project buildings holding flashlights.
So the whole thing is, as you like sit back now and you think, it's very surreal. As it was happening, it's just like, it was amazing. No, but all those memories, like, I was always, like, very starstruck, like, one of those, like, I gotta be cool. Oh, my God, I'm about to meet, like, Del the Funky Homo Sapien. Yeah. Like, when Del came up to me, the first time I met him, he was like, you're Eon, right? Oh, you had that, and he knew one by one, because I don't know, that shit was like kind of rocking back then. Like,
right. Fucking beat, banging. Best song.
Rapping over it and shit, and he was like,
banging.
He was like, yo, man. He was like, I didn't really like you at first, but he's like, you got a lot better. I was like, thanks, man. Like, to me, I was like, oh my God. Like, that was amazing. Like, yeah. You know, that was, you know, so I have like a lot of those. And like when Pharoahe, you know, thought that we dissed him and we were sitting at the airport and we had met him for 10 minutes. He's like, I gotta ask you something, man. What did you diss, you know, like on that? And it was again, you know, trying to be cute, like Munchie Cheese. I was like, no, Pharoahe. I was like, in my way, I was like, no, man. I was like, you're like one of my heroes, like without saying that. But so, like, it just what it is. It's like, I'm just like one of you guys, and I just happen to do this. And it's, you know, it was awesome, and it's great.
Who would be your most starstruck moment? What MC or what, you know?
I think like Run DMC. We got, and that's what it would be. Like, then you just started rolling with the tide. Like, that was the Salem Lights tour. You know, those cigarette guys got a lot of money.
Hell yeah.
So we were just with Run DMC. We had a bus and they had a bus. That. It was like, you know, then there were that's another, like, the money part is hilarious. So, like, yeah, when I met them, I was just like, yo, and I think I was like, yo, it's an honor. You know, I hope we can represent well and, you know, whatever. And that, you know, so I think Run DMC for sure was like the most.
Were they good to you? Were they good to you?
They barely interacted with us. I think we had like three interactions.
I'm sure Run was like, fuck out of here.
Mai said he got on the, like, on the elevator at the hotel once and DMC got on. He was like, yo, man, like, we're on the show with you or something like that. That's, you know, fine. Like. Because, you know, we obviously don't look the part either.
So, Run DMC over Beetlejuice?
The hell is your problem? They always smile and say, hey, Beetle, how you doing? How you smell?
Oh, no, yeah. Well, Beetle is just, yeah, he's, that was fun, but.
Y'all some lazy motherfuckers, man.
Now, whose idea was Beetlejuice to get on the cover and on the record?
I think
on
we just were like, I think it was really like Mighty Mai. And we were like, we just got to make it as, you know, real crazy.
Come on, you can't talk about these people like that.
You know, just completely absurd.
What the fuck is y'all guys trying to do?
You're totally going for shock value.
That was the independent way, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, we were just trying to do something different than the High and Mighty. We both, like that shit, obviously.
Well, he was the hottest thing at that time on Stern, Beetlejuice. I mean, everyone couldn't get enough of him.
And it was cool. And that was pretty cool, you know? Yeah, that whole experience was amazing too. And like, you know, doing that was, you know, and we did, you know, we did Midnight Blue. I don't know if you know what that is. In New York City, on the public network, they had like this channel J. So it was like this low scale porn, and not even porn. It was like this woman, Robin Bird.
Robin Bird.
She would lay and she kind of looked okay, but she was like 50. She had like droopy tits, but you know, she would, then they would
lie
have like
back, commercials, get comfortable.
The commercials for like the escort services. But then, you know, Midnight Blue, there's a guy like Al Goldstein.
It's sickening, and the people on television are even more sickening. Fuck you all.
Dude, I used to watch Midnight Blue like when I was 12, like jerking off, like in my like grandmother's like back room.
That's crazy.
And be on it. You know, that's all it's about, man.
When I got the video for Bottom Feeders, I didn't know if I needed to jerk off or throw up. Because no, it was my
bugged, man. Yeah. Puking on bitches. It was a snorting coke off asses.
Dude, so imagine that I am in a world like I have a 15-year-old son. So, you know, you have like normal, like white kind of people, contemporaries recently, like, you know, and then it's like, A, do they know? It's like this thing. It's like with me, it's like, you know, even in my business shit,
it's like you used to be in porn.
Googled you. Oh my God. I'm like, oh my God. So, like, you know, and I have so many things like that. And it was just, you know, there's just so many of those. It was just ridiculous. But like, so like, I played, so like, Bottom Feeders. I was like, oh, and I was like really high. It was like recently. It was like literally like last month. And I was like, oh, and I was with like these three women, like married, like, you know, like mothers, like just three white women. I was like, oh, you want to see something? And I just put on my phone and I handed it to them.
So depressed, I'm doing whippets for hours, cause I realize I'm less popular than what's happening now was. There are women in pits in my basement, my trophy, Morgana's tits in a glass encasement. Like my sidekick, Gary Hodnick, I'm still banging the Todd chicks, plus a hot bitch. Eon Reigns, fuckity hurricanes, you a cold front that's seen on every weather vane.
One of them was like, I really think of you differently. I was like, well, yeah, fuck you then. And like, so yeah, that one was crazy. And like all the videos we did were on so many different levels, you know. It was like, you know, the one for B-Boy Document was like very, very expensive. You know, it was like $200,000 something, you know. It was like effects and stuff they put on it and whatever. It was, you know, that was a director and they hired it. It was cute. It was fine. But then, yeah, like then when we could do our own stuff, then we were just wilding out. Like the Dick Starbuck one, they also, Raucous did it, but that was just like weird too. But we always, you know, but the videos were fun to do too, man. Those were awesome.
You mentioned your son. Does he know of
this material? He's not too interested in it, which is good. He's, I think like sometimes he, you know, he's told his friends and stuff, but, you know, they won't really, no one's ever like said, even him, I don't even think he's really, sometimes I'll like in the car, something will come up and I just play and I start like looking and seeing if he even knows it. And now he's 15. And if I put something, he'll be like, that's you, right? And I'm like, yeah. But then like, he's not like going on YouTube and like listening for it. He doesn't like download it and like listen to it, because why the hell would he?
Well, he's, yeah,
23 I mean, years old.
It's not Jack Harlow and, yeah, and yeah, you know.
Well, he though, and he likes, you know, like all the new shit, man. Oh,
sure.
He likes, yeah. So, but he likes hip hop, which is very interesting, and he just likes new stuff.
Tell the kids you have a song on Tony Hawk. That's what you gotta tell him.
That's the thing. I'm like, yeah, Lucas, there was this game way, way long time ago. Yeah. Like that. That's what he would like. Yeah. Because he's a big video game head. For sure.
Do you like any of his stuff?
Who?
Your son's. The stuff he likes. Do you like any of it?
No, but I mean, I just listen to it. Like a couple, it's one of those things when it's like you just get drilled in your head. You can kind of say, like, there's a couple
you
things.
Tolerate some of it.
I guess like when Champions came out, like Meek Mill, right? Mm-hmm. So that album, and he liked that. So like the two or three songs that were kind of, you know, like the one
not,
with Drake,
not terrible,
going bad,
eventually just got programmed into liking it. Yeah. You know? But
I'm with AE. My daughter's 17. I'm right there with you, man.
Yeah.
I try to show her shit like Hip Hop Parade. And I'm like, Listen, you'll like
no,
this.
No, it's because it's a different beat.
My daughter loves that shit, but she's 16 and she's cut from a different cloth. I mean, it just depends on how you introduce it. Right. But, you know, here's the funny thing. If you're walking down the street and you see Chuck D, what happens?
I would go up to him and be like, yo, man, thank you for everything. I want to tell you, you turned me into a rapper, and I went to your show. I have the ticket. It's April 17th, 1987.
Is that your guy?
Yeah, I love Chuck because he's old, and he's like a real sports like historian. You know, it's real New York, crazy high levels. Like, right. You know, played with Doc. You ever see the picture of him and Doc on like the playground?
Yeah.
Yeah. So
it's crazy. Yeah. He's an icon for me. And
have you seen his art?
Yeah. And so I met him a few times. I spoke with him a few times. It's still my get that I want on this show. It's the one interview I haven't been able to secure, but he means so much to me. And it's crazy because I miss that. Do you understand where I'm coming from when I say what I say?
No, I do. I think you're just, you know, think about how many hip hop of that era, you know, not many made it out of there, you know, like LL Cool J.
Yeah.
And like a few others, like the real, like from back then. So, you know, even Run DMC, man, like, you know, when like you know, like Down with the King and stuff, like I wasn't that into that song.
Right. But it was their resurrection in a lot of ways.
Right. But I think that happened to a lot of people. But Chuck D was also, he wasn't like a real flower. He's almost like a spoken word, like the way he rhymes is, and rhythmically, obviously, but I think he was also the most political besides KRS, and in a different way, you know?
Just missed that. You know, revolutionary generation.
And shifting back to the indie era, which is this episode.
Yeah, sorry.
Let's shit on somebody who we can all agree is a dickhead, and that's Ari the Rugged Man. Can I?
Yes, amen.
Dude, he's real weird, man. Like, I like his like humility.
Humility?
Insane. Not his humility. He makes his self-deprecating. Like he's sick.
Okay,
well, that's kind of shtickish, I think. I don't know if it's
that's his thing,
but he really does, and he is like that, man. Like, well, first of all, he may have like some kind of thing that he's always dealt with. He's talked about it, I think. Like
we all have something we deal with.
Well, yeah.
I'm not that empathetic. I'll tell
you. I had whole things with him where we had whole fights, not physical fist fights, but like going back and forth where he was being ridiculous about so many things. So yeah, I know about those things.
Yeah. I don't want you to let people in on things that are private or happening with you guys, but we've had many, many guests on this show, the greatest producers of all time, some of the greatest rappers of all time. There's never been an interview where I have not enjoyed like the RA. And I think RA, he's just an unlikable guy. He's an incredible MC. Right. But I think it doesn't matter how good you are of an MC. If you're not likable, it's very hard to get behind. Kind of like the way people are with LeBron.
Well, my experience with RA was he was moody, and he would have like one day where he was like kind of shitty or in a shitty mood, and he would just be shitty. But then he would always be like, yo, man, I'm sorry. Not that that's a thing, because people do that all the time and they just keep doing it. I kind of think maybe he does. But to be honest, I really haven't had a lot of interactions. I guess he's in Germany. He has like kids. So
I read a couple things, E, that number one, he kind of regrets doing the Smut Peddlers and the stuff that you guys did 20 some years ago, which
come on, you can't talk about these people like that.
The album is a classic. It's an underground classic.
Kiss your blast.
You can't take shit so fucking serious. Take it for what it is. Did you get upset about Two Live Crew? Come on, son. Like, right. Take it for what it is. And then also Cage, same thing. He wants apparently today in his fucking weirdo life, he wants nothing to do with Smut Peddlers. He'd rather have long hair and cut himself.
Well, yeah, there's two Cages. I mean, you guys got the good Cage. The Cage that looks like Ash from Euphoria, but like an older version. Like, yeah. You got like the prime Cage, and then there's the Cage that, you know, went on with Shia LaBeouf, and like you said, got that skater haircut where he's constantly got to move his hands across his fucking forehead because the hair is in his eyes. Like, that's not the Cage we wanted to listen to.
Lose you guys 75 got, pounds.
You guys got the good Cage. You worked with a lot of folks, but I just want to write off a few because EC, like I said, was so important during this time. You guys put out so many good records, not just of High and the Mighty, not just the compilations, but you somehow managed to get like Tame One out of retirement or wherever the fuck he was.
So good.
You know, that was a great album, the Leak Brothers. Yeah. I mean, talk a little bit about the EC run because it was pretty dominant for.
Yeah, and
for,
hey, for and Copyright, that motherfucker was a monster. Yeah,
another
then.
One, Copyright.
Yeah, monster.
Man. Yeah, I thought we definitely had, you know, we at like when we hit our peak, you know, like as the Raucous thing was ending. I really Evidence. Felt that's when we kind of like had everything. That's right. Like when we were able to get Tame, it was just meeting people and being like, look, like, well, first of all, Mai had all these beats. It was like, okay, you come here. We had a formula. It was like, all right, Tame, you come here. Here's beats. And now, you know, like we would do like our formula was like 80% Mai. And then like you'd have, you know, your Jay Zone beat here, Al. You know, Seb, you know, all those, you know, kind of like Reef, you know, put in here and there. So, you know, you had like different stuff like that.
Do you recall like in the early stages of Tame One coming on board? And because I know he's a great guy, but a very unique kind of a guy, you know?
Yeah, well, he was always like real good with us. But like sometimes like during shows, he would just go and like power drink and like smoke like dust and some shit and just be like some other person. And I've been with him on stage where he's thrown up on stage oh, and shit. Like kind of backs up and just kept going and people like and it was like, you know, crazy.
Power puke.
That was insane. But yeah, I mean that and like, you know, like so like we went back to our roots. Like, I don't know if you remember the Rip Shop record.
Yeah,
that one.
Super dope.
And, you know, and so Rip Shop was in like the Mixed Nuts. So that goes back to like the Boston time. So mm-hmm. like, you know, we did that and Acrobatic. And then, you know, and Copyright. And that's what it was, is Raucous gave us a certain amount per record. So we would also just go to people and be like, Copyright, you have, you know, and people would have like 65% of an album done. So then Mai would do four songs, five, maybe I was on it, or like mm-hmm. then Cage was on it, or someone was on it, you know, like High Exalted was probably almost all the way done. And then eventually, you know, maybe a couple other things were done. We just all would just be interchangeable. That's why we would do a show. We could go to Europe with me, Cage, and Copyright. And it would be like four different acts. It'd be Cage, High and Mighty, Spunk Peddlers, Copyright. And we would literally be able to do just interchangeable. So, you know, it was just like we were just able to, the Raucous thing allowed us to put out all those, you know, things. And then I don't know if you remember like some of the art, we would have this guy, Brian Life. It's also from Boston. He did all those and like it was like our thing. And we just, you know, we kind of had a good formula for sure.
Hey, being from Columbus, how the hell did you guys find Copyright?
Well, that was an RJD2 and, you know, like Bobbito thing, because Megahertz, I don't know how Bobbito even linked up with them. I think maybe RJ, I guess.
RJ is the shit.
Yeah, he really is. Philly. And so he brought them in, and then, you know, we were just like, you know, Copy was fucking incredible. It's like, listen to this guy. It's like, okay. You know, it's like Tame. Okay. Cage. Like, you know, it was like, it was great. We had a lot of talent around us. And then like, you know, rest in peace, Camu, man. Like, you know, we would just have these days where just everyone was just sitting there and like, we would just do stuff. So it was, you know, we were lucky.
I heard in an interview with Be Real many years ago where he decided at one point he had to have an affect to his voice to stand out. And clearly people are listening to you now. This is I don't want to date ourselves, but 20 some years later.
Yeah.
So our voices do change, but
yeah.
Bobby Brady syndrome.
Your voice, your voice stood out. It was always unique. And for the longest time, I didn't even know you were a white guy. I think right. I didn't know until the liner notes of the CD. I'm like, whoa. when did you realize like that was, like that voice, it's such a unique voice. Is that something you worked on or that came to you naturally when you were?
It was just the way I did it, I think. I don't know. Even in high school, like all my friends were like, you sound like Rakim. And I did, like in like 88. Not good, not, you know, lyrically, but, you know, like voice wise. And so I guess I just, you know, would just go into that. And it's just like, you know, it's also just the headphones and you're just like transformed. That's just the way it
when
is for me.
Dre talks sexy to his wife, he usually gets that Barry White voice.
Yeah.
So right. It's sort of like that.
Yeah.
Like you have, okay.
Oh, yeah. It works wonders. Let me
yes.
tell you.
Hey, I got a question. Weatherman, Yak Balls, who is that?
Yak Balls is the best. What do you mean? You don't know Yak Balls?
No, what I mean is, like, where did that come from? He came out of nowhere. He's good as hell. He was on the album.
Well,
how did
no,
that come about?
That's then there's the so that's another thing. You know what Footwork was, right? Bobbito's store.
Yeah.
So store. In the East Village, I lived on 5th between A and B when I moved to New York out of Boston. So I was right near the store.
They steal the doors off your cars back then at that area.
Right, exactly. It was three kids. It was Vaz. So I don't know if you know. Did you see the Bobbito and Stretch documentary.
Yeah,
I don't know if
ago.
You know who Vaz is, but Vaz is like, he was just like in the scene and, you know, he like has all the Stretch tapes and he's just a graffiti head, like just a New York head. And then DJ Ellie, I don't know if you know him, he did stuff on Fondalum too. And he did some cuts. He was actually DJing my wedding. And he's like a big like house DJ now in New York. And then Yak. And so, you know, and he worked there. Yash. And so he worked there. And so like they all hung out. And so like you'd go in there and they'd be like rhyming and stuff. So, you know, Bobbito put out, you know, I guess some of the first Yak stuff, Yak Balls. And then like again, that album, he kind of did it and we were able to put it out because people would come to us with albums. And we'd be like, okay, we're going to give you this money. Let's talk. And we would just give an advance. And then we'd be like, all right. And like whatever machine, like either we were with Land Speed or we put out money or whoever was just, you know, distributing it, they just would, you know, like want to do it. Like with Copyright's album, Yak Balls album, you know, like some people would come to us with like whole, you know, like the mostly the whole album done. Crazy one-offs of like Leak Brothers and Nighthawks, you know, like that shit. So we just could make an album because we all hung out together. So Camus and Cage are like, let's do Nighthawks, you know, and stuff like that.
I heard Yak on the Five in the Clip. When did this Weatherman thing come about? Like, was it one day at a show, everyone decided like, this is the group we're gonna... Because the super group was always a thing.
Yeah, I think, no, it was really Cage and I think LP and, like, I think Breeze and, like, and Yak and them. Like, so I think it was more, like, people like those guys who kind of, like, started talking about it. And then people started to either be in it or not. Like, I was in it for a second, but then I wasn't in it. And, like... It was kind of clicky a little.
Because it went from EC to Definitive Jux, right?
Well, that's what it was. So we just did that mixtape, you know, and like when we did, you know, The Conspiracy, mm-hmm. you know, which like every one of them is on it. And it's like that, like think about that. You couldn't make that shit now. Like an LP's on it and, you know, Vast and like Copy. And like there's whole, like, so then Copy would just do a song. So that would be on there. I mean, then everything went to what it went to. And like then, you know, Cage and Copyright and everyone got, you know, were done with us and they go move on. And then there was that part.
Do you have many, many years? I don't know if things have changed, but do you have any relationships with any of these guys that you know you once worked with back in the EC days?
Yeah, like, but mostly like social media and like stuff like Tame. When we did our New York show, Tame came.
Okay.
There was like no one there. It was like Memorial Day weekend or Labor Day weekend or some shit. But we did that show. I did talk to Cage up until like right at the beginning of the pandemic. But I mean, I have his number, his last number, I think, if I texted him or something. But, you know, like Mai and him talk. And I, you know, me and Mai are obviously still talk like a lot. And we, you know, we haven't lived in the same city in a long
time. He's in Vegas, right?
Yeah. He's been in Vegas for as long, like 16 years. Like
He's been clean for how many years now?
For alcohol. Many years.
I mean, he's lost a significant amount of weight. He looks good and he's.
Yeah, he's been like that. Just really through, through like Instagram. Like when Thurston Howe put out the record, I mean, when he put out his book, like I reached out. I was like, yo, man. See, I just like give people their flowers on stuff. Like I talked to Pharoahe and we text about the Mets. So that's what I talked to him about and like cards. And I've actually been in, you know, I don't know if you see his Instagram. He really collects like figures.
Pharoahe?
Yeah.
I spoke to him 2 hours ago.
Yeah. All I'm saying is one time I was in a store and I texted him like on like Twitter or something. I was like, dude, I'm in this. I see a lot of figures. Let me know. Like
he's a huge nerd.
All right, so you look at Jay at what he's got behind him.
Of course. Well,
I see you at a blank wall. What do you have that is your like claim to fame?
He has a Lenny Dykstra rookie card with some tobacco stains on it.
No, seriously, like what's your one thing that like you're proud of? Whether it's music, memorabilia or baseball or what's your one thing?
No, I think music. And I think like just that I was, you know, in my life, the other things like hip hop is still part of my life. And, you know, obviously when you're a father, you know, I just want to do everything with him. So I just, you know, my son is like a Marvel, you know, he was in Star Wars, just like, you know, it's like the most beautiful. It's like all you really want in life. Like I literally had all the Star Wars figures from when I was a kid. They were played with. They weren't, you know, perfect. And I was like, when I was like 10, I was like, I'm going to save these for my kid. And I'm going to play with these with my kid. And you do it.
So you have all the figures from the early 80s.
Yeah, dude. And then I have a movie of me when he's 4 and I dust off the Darth Vader case and I just open it and I'm showing him. And then like I have ones where the first things he learned is the figures like Greedo, Chewbacca, R2-D2, like he's saying it, like he learned. So like, dude, all of it. And then, you know, I've talked to this guy a lot about the last 2 years, like with back in the, like, you know, cards has just been, you know, it's been great, insane and great. And, you know, I'm just trying to get my Ricky Henderson room.
How about, you're talking to the right guy here. There's a guy,
10 times more Ricky Henderson stuff than this guy. How about that dude? What's that guy's name?
Oh, Ricky 939, Kent?
Yes. Dude.
Yes.
That dude has like a whole apartment.
No, I know. If I was dedicated to just one thing, I would, but I have, I'll quickly show you because you said Star Wars.
Yeah, man. Woo! Right.
Can you see all those figures?
Yeah, well, we all don't have like a serious room. God, when you were building it, I was like, Jesus Christ, this guy.
So what'd you think of the Boba Fett, the Book of Boba Fett?
It's good. I know everyone, the Mandalorian was in it too much. It's dope.
Nerd!
Of course, like you're going to be critical about it. But think about 10, 15 years ago, the thought that there would be a Boba Fett show. That's like something like when you were 15, like you would say, what do you want to see most in your life? You'd be like, it's the Boba Fett show. And it was like, and then you fucking got it. So I won't complain. All that shit. Like, and then we're going to, you know, all this stuff, it's like gravy. It's like, you know, I say when I was 1983. I was 11 years old.
I was Jedi.
There were 9 hours or 10 hours, including little specials of content. And my son has seen hundreds, 500 hours of content. And he knows it all. He knows it much better than me. He'll go into the Clone Wars and be like, so that's him and my music career. So being able to absorb all my weird
nice.
Shit,
yeah.
You know, besides like the porn stuff, but he's a little sicko. No, but he's real sicko. I don't know if you know about 15-year-old, 16-year-old boys. Yeah.
Right. 15, 16. Exactly. He's probably has a sock like Kev. Kev used to keep a sock near Please. His baseball cards.
Hell yeah.
Next to his Kevin Moss rookie cards, it would be a right. yellow sock.
I worked at a video store, so I had all the fucking videos back in the day.
And Dre, like, did you have the sheet that you had to pull aside to go into that room?
Yeah, of course, man. I worked at a video
all
store.
All the good video stores.
Before Blockbuster, bro.
Beads. Oh, you got to go through the beads.
And you used to get a free videotape when you signed up. And when we signed people up, I never gave them the videotape. And all I would do is like duplicate porn back in the back room, and I'd keep it with myself. That's it.
That's so funny you say that, because I think Mighty Mai's first job, it was at a place called Video City, which was on 20, do you know that spot? It's on 20th and like between Pine and Spruce, right? And it's still there, and it's like a digitizing place now. But this was a video store in the 80s, and he used to take the porn and bring it home. And
of course.
Like some of the first ones that we would see.
That was our life, you know.
And now Dre jerks off to Chrissy Canyon in his Oculus 2.
I got my Oculus. It's fucking fantastic. I'm trying to explain to them that Oculus is so fantastic when it comes to this next level shit.
I have a friend who is like, it's crazy. They're like whispering in your ear.
But here's the thing. If you get anyone over 40... you see every line and shit. You got to get into that perv shit. And I'm like, I got to go below the 35 age, and it's creepy because I got kids, and it's a whole thing. Fuck it.
We're becoming a bunch of pervs now.
It's not
on
good.
This show.
It's not good.
We didn't even bring up Ashlyn Gear yet.
Who?
She was my favorite. Ashlyn Gear.
Yeah.
Back in the day, it was shit. Come on. You had Seika. You had, who's that blonde? Nina Hartley. They were scary girls back in the day.
Yeah,
you know, Hartley.
Bill, totally. Janine Lindenmuller.
Yeah, she was great. Peter North used to bust mad loads. It's crazy that we're speaking about this, but hey, smut peddlers are in the fucking house, man. Yes. This is what we're talking about.
So
was it hard?
You guys, go ahead, Dre. No, I'm sorry, Jake.
By the way, you look like LL Cool J for some reason tonight, like a white LL Cool J with his hat.
He does. Right? Lick your lips. Do your thing. Now say what LL says. Say it.
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
You know what I'm saying?
Nah, I was just going to make a bad joke since we were talking about being perverted. I was going to say, was it very hard to not jerk off to Rashida Jones
years? No, she was real cool. She's like actually, you know, like when a girl's like beautiful but not sexy?
Right.
That's what it is.
She was like homegirl, like, right? Homegirl.
Yeah, she was just like very like, you were like, damn, she should be a movie star, you know? And she, you know, like she had the face, like the bone structure, all that shit.
Was she ahead, like a real head? I mean, like her sister was engaged to Tupac, so I know she was always around this. And right. QD3 was an amazing producer in the 90s. So she's always been around the hip hop, but especially, you know, independent 90s hip hop. Did she really like that kind of stuff?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I think it was more that she lived with Mark and, you know, she wanted to do it. I don't know. I think she liked the song when we played it for her. I remember, like, she liked it or something. But, yeah, I don't even know if she would still know it or anything. But it was just, you know, like, she was, like, 20-something. So she's like, yeah, I'm going to sing on this rap song.
Props to Mark Ronson for going across a 20-something-year-old Rashida Jones. Props. Holy shit.
Yeah, man. He,
famous
he
kids. Roll with the famous kids, man. Dion, yeah. So during the course of Eastern Conference Records, you had the good and the bad fortune of being in the indie scene when it was hot as can be, And then also when the internet age came about and kind of wrecked the whole shit. So at what point did you guys go, okay, we made 7-8 albums, whatever that number is, maybe more. I think it's over and I think we should move on and do something else. At what point did that happen?
Well, I think it was like 2003. So, you know, we do the two of the three album deal with Raucous. And it's like, you know, after the Smut Peddlers, it was like, okay, you know, what are you going to do? And by that time, it was like 2002. And I think we were just like, I think for whatever reason, we kind of, you know, we broke up with them. And then that's when, you know, we went to Landspeed. So as that happened, also, like, you know, the Napster thing happened. So, like, the way I try to kind of equate it is when we put out our B-Boy document on Eastern Conference Records, you know, with the Jamal Shabazz, you know, photograph on there of the four, like, B-Boys, we sold, like, 30, 40,000 of them. Like, and that was us. Like, that's Eastern Conference. Like, you know, we did that. It wasn't Raucous Record. And then, like, the next record, like, when Air Force One came out and all that, we would sell, like, 200 records. So it was over. It was like, all the people who are now, like, 38 and 30, 40, who are, like, 18 in 99 or, like, 19, in that range, that 16, 17, 18, those were our fans. They were done with paying, like, unless you were a DJ, now you could listen to a song. You didn't physically have to buy something. So there was like, remember, like 03 and 04, it was a free-for-all. There was no regulation. No one knew how you were going to get paid. And so you just didn't. So I was living in New York City. At first, I lived in this little studio, and then I met my wife. So I first had a $450 studio. And then in 2003 and 4, I was paying $2,700 a month. And that's like paying $5,000 now. Wow. So lived in Manhattan. And then it just was like, holy shit. Like, this shit is drying up.
But it was pretty special when we were there. I mean, yeah. Not many people got to live that.
Right. And so I was like, okay. And look, I went to college. You know, I wasn't just going to think I was going to have a 50-year rap career. I wanted to have a family. So, and like, you know, me and Maya are like best friends. He's like my brother still. It's nothing, wasn't like a breakup or anything. It was like me and Maya lived from when we were 8 years old to 33 in the same city, whether it was Philly, Boston, or New York. So it was kind of like, and really hip hop was about doing it with Milo. He's my best friend. It's like, you know, that was a big part of, you know, I don't know. I wouldn't have had a rap career if me and him didn't do that together, because it was part of our friendship and part of our life. It was our life. So I think just Napster, like, cut it out. It was then 2004. And then, like, I couldn't afford it anymore. So 2005, I moved to Brooklyn. And, like, then we were going to have a kid. So then I was like, I need to get a job. And then that's when we moved back to Philly. You know, I've like had a real estate career for like 16 years. So it's just life, you know, but that's what happened. So when that shit happened, it was kind of over. But I think I could have done more. I could have been like, yo, you know, let's just keep doing it, doing albums and albums. But I don't know if I'd necessarily like that.
Well, you did a show 5 years ago, right?
I mean,
the itch every once in a while.
Oh, yeah. No, and I'm down to do something, too. Like, Milo is talking about moving back east.
You know, yeah?
Like, because Las Vegas, you know, he DJed in clubs for, you know, made a lot of money and did real well out there. And it's just, you know, part of his talent got him this blessing. And it's just beautiful. So maybe he comes back. Maybe we do something. But, you know, it was, you know, that was a hard time, man. That was, you know, that's all you knew, you know, mm-hmm. That's all I knew. So it was like, then it was like grow up real quick time. And that's, I guess, what I did.
Well, you know, you got to feel proud the fact that that EC name is synonymous with this whole indie era. And when you saw an EC record, whether it was on Sandbox or Hip Hop Site or Underground Hip Hop, you bought it. You bought it because of the track record. You bought it because the fact that you guys just continuously made bangers. Yeah. And like I said earlier in the show, you know, there's labels like Ruckus or Guess Wild, ABB, and Eastern Conference is right there in the same conversation as being the powerhouse indie labels that really kind of champion this indie movement. So, and for me personally, after the second golden era, like the indie era is probably my second favorite era in hip hop.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
I love the second golden era, you know, the 90 to 5, 93, 94, 95.
Right.
And then I loved this. I loved hearing Kool Keith. And I think, again, going back, you're like us. You have the same interests. You grew up, well, I don't know who's older, you or Dre. Probably Dre.
I don't know. September 71.
Eon.
I'm 72.
You're so older, Dre.
There you go.
But the point I'm trying to make is, you know, you grew up as a hip hop aficionado, an enthusiast, a lover, and you got to do something that many of us, exception of Wade did it for a little bit.
Yeah.
Couldn't even fathom. So kudos to you.
Thank you.
And, you know, I've always wanted to talk to you. Like I said earlier, we usually talk about sports and cards, yeah, and all that nerd shit, but talking, yeah, hip hop is cool.
Yeah, man. And I really appreciate this. And I love
this era that,
man. It's great. And I was like, I've chilled like since kind of like this year, just because my knee was starting to get jacked up. But like, I listened to y'all, you know, the whole thing running. So I really,
oh, wow, running.
Okay. Like, after like, I got divorced in six, like in the 15. And so like, I just like stopped drinking and smoking. Mm-hmm. And like, I just started running and I was like crazy. And so like, you know, it's been like that. Then I started smoking again, but and then, but
that helps, but, with the knee, yeah, though.
It's good. It's good for running, man. It's good.
Yeah. So I hear. Awesome. So I hear, man. Well, thank you. Thank you again, man. And don't stop your passion with the Eagles. Yeah. Hopefully, be a baseball back soon.
And the Sixers are about to win the
Sixers
NBA
are amazing right now. It's
see if they get past the Bucks. We'll see if they get past the Bucks.
First game, it was awesome, man.
And a lot of people, you know, that they follow you on IG. You want to give out your handle now, or if you don't want to give out,
I think it's E-Melts. E-M-E-L-T-Z.
And I gotta commend you for the love and passion you have with your son. It's always nice to see that, like a father son relationship.
Hell
so
yeah.
So big ups and what you were saying about Star Wars, it's the same thing with my son. So I totally relate and can appreciate that. You know.
Yeah.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's Mr. Eon, the High and the Mighty. Thank you so much for your time. I truly appreciate it.
All right, I appreciate it, guys.
Have a good night, bro.
PC.
All right. Yo, 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 what's up in the place to be? This is Mr. Eon from Eastern Conference Records, the High and Mighty, Smut Peddlers, Dick Starbuck, Porno Detective in the house. I am chilling with Filla Flavor, Kevlar, A. Aaron, a.k.a. Aaron Wade, and my man DJ 360. Take It Personal Radio, doing it big, doing it big. You are now in the mix.
From the bottom of our hearts, thank you for tuning in to another special episode of Take It Personal. Keep it locked. Roger the announcer. O-U-T.